Hello and welcome to the Zell Visiting Writers Series. We bring acclaimed authors to the University of Michigan throughout the winter and fall semesters, usually about 12 authors per year. And we are delighted to have Jenny Zhang with us here this evening. This event is being recorded and will be posted on YouTube. Live captioning is enabled. If you want to turn the captioning on or off, you can hit the CC icon on the bottom of your screen and choose the setting that works the best for you. A copy of Jenny's reading is available for anyone who would find that helpful, or parts of her reading, not all of it actually. And I'll post that in the chat in just a minute once everyone has logged in. In terms of how the event's going to run, we'll do some brief introductions. A student will introduce Jenny, Anisha will introduce Jenny, and then Jenny will give a 20-25 minute reading. There'll be a 30 minutes or so of conversation between Jenny and another student of ours, Der A, and then we'll open it up to audience questions. The Q&A portion, is you can submit a question through the chat. And if your question is selected, we'll enable your audio and video so that you can ask it yourself. If you prefer, I can ask it for you. Just indicate you submit the question. And it's also really nice if you can say a little something about who you are. You're an undergraduate student at the University of Michigan, or Jenny, from Ireland, or whatever, you know, just so we have some context about who's here and what brings you here. So I think that's it. So I will turn it over to Anisha to introduce Jenny Zhang. Thanks so much.
Okay, thank you so much, Ashley. I'm just gonna jump in, okay. In Jenny Zhang's poem, Your Whole Body is Slanted, the speaker asks, when did I agree to be a textbook for you and your whole dumb family? If I had to define Zhang's 2017 fiction debut, Sour Heart, I would probably write a strongly worded email to whoever assigned me such an impossible task. But after that, I would probably call it the spiritual opposite of a textbook. Her narrators, Chinese American girls, flip and fly through Zhang's work, code switching between Chinese and English, between belonging and alienation, between body and soul, always slipping through the fingers of those that would seek to define them. To read this book is to be invited into a way of thinking that is, though not new, chronically ignored in American literature. It feels like burrowing into a spectacular and bright brain, really embedding yourself in the soft tissue of these narrators. And it is every bit as disgusting as burrowing into a brain sounds, and also every bit as ecstatic. Upon emerging from these stories, I feel dazed, covered in brain goo. I feel as though I now need a manual to interpret anything that isn't Jenny Zhang's voice, as if I have forgotten everything except for that voice. It is that immersive. Of course, though she's here as a visiting writer in fiction, Jenny Zhang is also a poet, essayist, screenwriter, and general enemy of genre divides. My baby first birthday, her new book of poetry, follows a speaker through the horrible, beautiful first year of existence when there's nothing to separate life and living. In the poem, I keep thinking there is an August, the speaker exclaims, on how life is both impossible and happening at the same time. Zhang's work seems to capture that odd age of trembling, when the body is another marvel to be investigated, and like all effective but cruel searching, the searching leaves some of its own presence behind. All of this leads me to a fundamental truth that can be found throughout Jenny Zhang's work, poetry, nonfiction, and fiction, that it is damn hard to be a girl. But it is a complicated difficulty, full of tenderness and cruelty and tender cruelty and cruel tenderness, full of goop and goo and boogers and pubes and puberty. It is harder still to be a girl when you are in between, as her Chinese American protagonists always are. In one story, a protagonist drives herself into exhaustion by trying to look up every word in her school reading that she does not know, a Herculean task given that she must also look up all the English words in the dictionary definition that she doesn't know, and then the next definition, and so on, a hellish tree of language. It is exhausting to be a girl, and it is exhausting not to be the whole of one thing, rather parts of things. But within that exhaustion, the horrible slime of being, there is also a love so pure and tender that it hurts. Reading Sour Heart, I looked at this love and I hurt, and I was glad to be hurt. Please welcome Jenny Zhang, author of Sour Heart, My Baby First Birthday, Dear Jenny, We Are All Fine, winner of the Los Angeles Times Book Prize, the Penn Robert W. Bingham Prize for debut fiction, and being a person of so many accomplishments that I do not have time to list them all today. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thank you so much for that intro. I feel so honored, and I'm really happy to be here. I wish I could meet you guys in person. And I know that's just a refrain for this current moment. It was a brilliant introduction. But I will make do with speaking into my own face on my own laptop as you all watch me do so. I think I'll read the first poem that was mentioned. It's called Your Whole Body is Slanted. Your whole body is slanted. Why did you touch me there between my fingers? It feels like a mountain range. Well, I'm very sick these days. I keep telling my friends I'm not a liberal, not a conservative. What are you then? I can be traced back to the tiny dancer Flaubert loved. He was pedestrian. Other canonical men knew my mother, painted her so wrong, did not know how a nose like hers really looked in profile. I was 7, then 8, then 9, then dead. What I would give to not be read as a means of instruction. When did I agree to be a textbook for you and your whole dumb family? My people make history if they just stay alive. Well, anything is easy if your existence is wanted. Admit you want me to have a function. Admit you can't imagine someone touching you the way you touch me. You don't like being bought or sold. And what I must tolerate, you have never, ever. I'll just read the next poem in, because it's right there. And it's hard to take breaks and like banter with no one because it just feels like, well, it just feels like I'm talking to myself, which is what I already do all day. But the banter is like usually when I like look around and think about what to read next, but that's gone now. So I'll just read what's already next. This is a poem called Needs Revision. I like the story of the monkey who was inside that woman, and when she met that man who fucked her without asking about pain or pleasure or desire or terror, he was really fucking the monkey inside her who told her to stop. If only we all had a monkey, but actually, no. No to wanting someone else to do the work for us. No to wanting someone to feel our pain. No to thinking everything can be outsourced. Someone has to feel it. It might as well be me. Just because I have let monsters love me shouldn't mean I get to hit whoever I want. And yes, I want to hit everyone. Walk around with my fists by my side. Like a spring, I knock down everything around me. The horror is always the same. What fell were the flowers, leaving just the ragged hedges, the immovable trunks of trees. Everything ugly remains. The bleeding is just on one side. The same people care and the same people don't. I don't know, man. Was I wrong to assume I was straight? What else was in me all along that I never nurtured? I point out sadist after sadist, but don't know how to look at myself. Well, all around us are people who don't know until someone calls for a boycott and someone else with no disposable income promises publicly they won't spend it. I honestly don't know how to scare the fuck out of him. He has too much money to care. It sucks that even white girls can't get justice and the rest of us are supposed to keep writing about the time someone put their hand up our legs, the time someone put something else up something else. It's just holes. It's just ugly appendages. It's just an orifice. It's just someone's entire history of violence. It's just going dead inside for 1 to 7 minutes. It's just sleeping in unwanted sperm. It's just someone's parent who knows their son and he would never hurt anyone. It's just marrying someone who has offshore accounts in the Seychelles and using bitcoins to buy more land in Puerto Rico. It's just writing on Instagram, best decision I ever made, marrying this one. Now no one is afraid to get drinks with this one. He's safe because he married a nerd who thinks she's a 19th century aristocrat. Everyone with secret wealth publicly fetishizes rich people's ideas of thrift. It sucks I'm too violent to be praised by actually powerful people. They prefer the dummies who feel sorry for all the Roman Polanski films they can't stream anymore on moral grounds. They'll only retweet that article about how women are monsters too. I mean, get fucking real. Did someone with this level of professional achievement actually agonize for 3 weeks over watching that scene in Annie Hall where Diane Keaton cucks Woody Allen so gracefully and deceptively? I once saw a group of future men going their own ways actually praise the movie as if it weren't the nightmare they wrote their manifestos against. Hashtag goals for a white supremacy that outlaws any dick stiffening outside a vagina. The followers of Thor's hammer can't get enough of these sideways Asian cunts. They worship Odin, but can't get hard unless there's a chink around. I guess it's true women are so powerful that a single drop of cum landing anywhere but inside our wombs would destroy Western civ. Can anyone resolve then how a single drop of unwanted cum can make my friends and I actual survivors? I would never call myself a survivor just because that skinny little pencil dick went in and then fell out. Too skinny, I screamed. It hurts all the more thanks to all the unused surface area. How did both of us come away from that thinking each other was the Nazi? When I was 14, I actually prayed for someone to rape me. How was I supposed to know what that word meant, how it would actually feel? It was the fastest route to attention. All the other ways I was broken didn't count. How was I supposed to know nothing counts if you're a woman in pain? How was I supposed to know the more I talk about my pain, the more white people literally profit? How was I supposed to know then? I was already eroticizing my trauma in order to seem luckier than the girls I knew who talked in terms of disfigurement. Are there any women left who haven't cried on tape? Every time I say something, a man I've never thought about even once in my life lets me know how it makes him feel. This is one of the best strategies to get me to think about you. What a fucking prison it is to be inside this femme mind. I wish it could end right here. But actually, pessimism is more than sane. This body has never been touched consensually. Are you kidding me? Exploitation doesn't just stop because I started doing mad push-ups and worked on my core. I hate this reality, but neither will I just die. I will live, okay? I will bite my tongue until it's gone, not to make any kind of point, though it is true, one way to seize the means of production might be self-mutilation, might be suicide without a note, no warnings on Facebook, no threats on Twitter, just go away. Let the paper write an obituary for someone who resembles you. The dead don't laugh, they don't applaud heroic acts. They don't have unfinished business. They aren't salvation for the living. They are dead, 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 and deserve at least some rest. I'm going to read some fiction. Thank you for spending any of your time listening to me. Let's see. And thank you for the closed captioning. I don't imagine that is easy to keep up. I would have a hard time doing that. So I'm very grateful. Thank you. I guess I'll read a section from My Days and Nights of Terror. It's a story from Sour Heart. Okay. I'm just trying to decide which part to read. I wish I could get feedback from you guys. Should I read something? I don't know. What do people want me to read? I feel like I used to always read the same thing, but now it seems like wrong to read what I would always read.
Penny, if you'd like, I can encourage people to put requests in the chat if you want. If you want it to be structured that way, that could also be disorienting for you. It's up to you.
If anyone has any, like a vibe that they're interested in, please say so in the chat. Okay. I guess I'll read this section where this 12-year-old girl, Mandy, has just moved to a new neighborhood. She's going to a school that's supposed to be better than the school in her old neighborhood, but she actually finds it more terrifying. And it is, I guess, from the perspective of childhood. So that is a vibe. So she's talking about, this new neighborhood that she's in and how her parents, I'll just read, sorry. I'm hemming and hawing too much. You love your new school, don't you? My parents asked me. It's the same. The same? You call a 20% dropout rate versus 40% the same? You call standardized testing scores in the 80th plus percentile for more than half the seventh grade class the same as half the kids are dope fiends and the other half drug dealers? That's your idea of the same? Geez, Dad, I just mean it feels the same to me. Well, try to feel harder. Honey, my mother said to my father, she's feeling as hard as she can. Sweetheart, my father said to my mother, do you really think Mandy is trying as hard as she can? Is she really trying as hard as we try to get her into this school? Is she trying as hard as spending the last 2 years filling out 40 forms and making hundreds of phone calls and faxes and Xeroxes? As hard as conceiving this plan more than 5 years ago in advance? I thought I was trying, but what did I know? What did my parents know? They were home most nights for 3, sometimes 2, sometimes 1, and occasionally 0 of the hours that I was awake. And what did they actually have time for in those 3 or 2 or 1 or 0 hours, other than cooking dinner and refrigerating it, in case the next day was one of those days where I saw them for 1 or 0 hours? Or they were arguing over who had run down this month's savings to a measly $60 when the goal was $250, something that they had agreed upon and very meticulously budgeted for, or going over my homework to make me see how important it was to not just get a 99 in spelling, but a 100, not just get a very good on my English test, but a this is perfect. There's no such thing as this grade, I said, putting it in air quotes. Perfection always exists, my father said. Just look at your mother. ugh, I said. Maybe perfection did exist, maybe it was out there, but it only lasted as long as a sneeze. In a day or a week or in another few minutes, my father would lose that moony look in his eyes, my mother would fall from his esteem, and they would be estranged again, enemies once more. He would grab her by her throat or twist her arm or hit her in the face until she was quiet. She would grab a knife from the kitchen and say that she was going to stab him to death. And then herself, wouldn't that just be great for everyone? I would hate him for hating her. And then I would hate her for hating him. And then I would hate myself for not protecting my mother. And then I would hate my mother for needing me to protect her. And then I would hate my father for causing my mother to need that protection. And finally, I would hate them both for insisting that the person who really needed protection was me. And if I had any chance of surviving, I would have to be better than perfect. What I wanted to know was that if my own parents couldn't even be satisfactory to each other, then why was I expected to be perfect? So I was fed, and I was looked after, and I was encouraged to be perfect. And I was told over and over that life would always improve, that this was how anyone at all was supposed to live, by striving, by being perfect when you were young. And it was still easy to be perfect because just wait, my father would say, just wait until you're older. But I didn't need to wait. I was young now, and I found it so fucking hard. In the 3 or 2 or 1 or 0 hours I saw my parents every night, I kept waiting for them to ask me new questions, like how many friends did I have at school? And was it hard to be the new girl? And did I ever feel lonely when I came home from school and had to wait to see if this was a night of 3 or 2 or 1 or 0 hours with them? And how was I coping with all the walking all the way to the Q12 bus stop on my own? Did strange men on the bus ever approach me and try to ask me if I wanted to make several babies with them, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. At school, I crept around like a scared mouse, darting from one classroom to another when the bell rang, hoping not to be accidentally hit by spitball or to open my locker to the smell of fresh dog shit or look at someone I wasn't supposed to ever make eye contact with. Someone was always trying to beat on someone, and the most notorious of the someones was this 9th grader, Soojin. She was the leader of a Korean gang, and she was a true knockout. The kind of beautiful that was unapproachable and heightened by rumors of her sadism. You wanted to stare at her, but you couldn't. It would get you jumped, or worse. She made the word feminine look even more dangerous than it sounded. She wore a thick velvet choker with a little studded cross that dangled softly when she walked. Wherever she was flanked by her 2 best friends, Yoonsung and Eunice, who were only permitted to wear plain, thick, non-velvet chokers and never with a charm. They had stubby necks that reminded me of how my Barbies looked after I snapped their heads off and screwed them tightly back in, whereas Soojin's neck was long, white, and clean. She was the kind of creature who could have been painted and kept in a fine art gallery if only someone was allowed to look at her long enough to memorize the sharp angles of her cheekbones and her finely plucked eyebrows and her lippy, pouty scowl that was more alluring than any smile I'd ever seen on anyone else. She was a gangster with the face of a heartbreaker. Soojin was never alone, and that was how you knew she was powerful. She belonged to an order of teenage girls who would do anything for her without her even having to ask. She had adherents, and the rest of us had friends we couldn't even count on. Besides Yoonsung and Eunice, there were a dozen or so girls in her posse. And plenty more who tried to join but weren't allowed in. I overheard in pre-calc that apparently Soojin ate pussy like there was no tomorrow. Did you know, I told my friend Peggy after school when I was over at her house waiting for my parents to come pick me up, that you can eat pussy? I mumbled the word, ashamed by the possibility that I had been the one to make Peggy aware of it, as I sure as hell didn't know that word when I was her age. And if she was anything like me, then it meant I was her fan pin. It was a horrifying thought. Fan pin is like this bully that this narrator had when she was younger that exposed her to like a lot of stuff that she wasn't into. Peggy said, my dad says that's a racist thing people say to put down Chinese people. I'm not talking about cats, I said. I'm talking about the hole you pee out of. You're supposed to let guys put their thing in there, and that's what happens when you get a boyfriend. Disgusting, she said. Yep, I agreed. Does God know about this? He knows everything. Oh, she said. It was yet another thing my parents didn't know to warn me about. And the more I thought about it, the more it excited me. That night, I got under the covers and tried to pray, but couldn't stop laughing at the thought of my vagina as a lollipop, something sweet, something to desire. I wondered who, if anyone, would ever desire me in the way I desire to be desired. So far, I had only ever fended off my enemy, Fanpin, whose desire for me was a cancer and a stain. But maybe if I were truly desirable, if more people wanted me the way she wanted me, I would have developed some real muscle, some real grit. Maybe it was all the better that I wasn't beautiful. After all, I hadn't even been decent looking when I had to resort to violence to defend myself against Fanpin's advances. What would I have to do if I'd been a knockout like Sujin? My Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, grant me strength, I prayed, in an attempt to resist the image of Fanpin's 9-year-old face appearing before me, asking me to pretend sleep next to her with her crotch pressed up against my butt. Doesn't this feel nice? She used to ask me. Watch over me in my hours of darkness. Protect me in spirit as well as in body when I sleep. Stop moving around so much, she used to say every time I wiggled away to keep some distance between us. I will forever honor you. I am wholly yours, your humble servant through whatever trials and tribulations that may test me. This isn't right, I used to say. My mom says I can only do this with my future husband or with her. Please help me to confront tomorrow with unwavering faith and without fear. Whenever I mentioned a boy, Fanpin would snap. Even if it was just an imaginary boy who was supposed to grow up and woo me into marriage one day. She'd say, well, who told you to be such a little mommy's girl? And who says you have to get married to a man? She was wild and I was meek. Even in her total wrongness, she would get a thing or two right. Like how my parents were more naive than I was if they thought what they had was something I would want one day. Please, I begged God, show me the right way to live. I didn't dare utter Fanpin's name, though her presence was smeared all over my prayers. She had given me a structure and a vocabulary to speak to God all those years ago when I didn't know if I was doing it right. And now, speaking to God, how she spoke to God, I felt simultaneously distant from him and too close to her. She had wormed her way into my devotion. She had entered the part of me that was supposed to be only available to him. Dear God, I am sorry. I have to say it the way I want to say it. Look, I need a sign. I know I'm not supposed to, but I need you to tap me on the shoulder when I'm walking to my first period class. I need you to drop a leaf on my book bag when I'm waiting for the bus. I just need to know you're really there. I'm sorry. I know that's wrong. Only the faithless rely on signs and symbols. Only the selfish ask for their prayers to be answered directly. I know it is wrong to demand of you. I know, I know, I know, I know, I know. But I am so lost. I am afraid every night before I go to sleep, and I am afraid every morning when I wake. Is it normal to wake up disappointed I've survived another day? Sometimes I think it would be better not to wake up at all, never to have known what it was like to have lived a life. Is it too late? Will I always know this life? I can't imagine beyond this world, there is another. I want to believe in your kingdom and your bounty, but I can't imagine it. I want to move on, but to what? To where? Most days, I can't imagine a tomorrow until it's already yesterday. Am I supposed to just keep waiting? Why did you create life? Is it so wrong to wish you had never made me or my mother or my father or their mothers and fathers and all the mothers and fathers who came before them? All I've ever known about any of them is how much pain they went through. And I'm just supposed to go through it too? Well, forgive me if I don't fucking feel like it. If I don't want to be a story my children rant about to their children when I'm dead, forgive me. Fucking forgive me. Good night. I'll read one last short poem and then we can chat. Lots of vibes. I suppose I could read this poem. It's called I wonder, I kind of now want to read two things, but maybe that's too much. I think I'll read this poem called "The Morning of Yesterday's Yesterday is for Once Soft." My grandfather's afterlife, a locker room full of the ashes of martyrs. The gooey dead walk soft and sweet on my two capable feet. They go where I go. They pet me when I'm the most alone. They tell me I can. I absolutely can. And I will read one more poem just because why not? And this is called Fidget. I feel too sad to live. That's what everyone keeps saying. I want to meet someone who knows how to live. Is this person on the internet? Is this person on TikTok? I tell my mom I'm happy and life is good, but busy. I tell her I don't need to have a family. I can go to bed earlier if I want to. I would like it if she heated up porridge in the morning. There is so much to tell so many people at so many different times in my life. I feel like I am drunk again, though not sloppy. What if I am not a very good person? There it is again, needing answers. I keep thinking, what if this had happened? What if that had happened? What if I had done this at that time? What if everything was different? What if people could stop telling me to stop wondering about what could have been? Because maybe all of this is important. Maybe I cannot be anything else right now, but I still want to be anything. I still want to go back into the past and change how everything was and change myself back then so I wouldn't have to change as much now. I wake up early. I wake up screaming. These clothes have no future. I think I see someone I used to know on the street. I cannot move and I wish I were dead. I honestly wish I were dead. I pretend to be my own friend and I say to me, as my friend, if you really wanted to be dead, I'm just saying. There are a lot of good experiences to be had, but not right now. I could be writing really well, but not right now. right now, I can't do anything. I want to be free and alone, not talking about cunts and everyone who wants to destroy one. I don't want to drive a bus full of cunts. I don't want to apply for insurance in case one of these cunts dies. I don't want to write cunt death below the dotted line. It's not like I'm not aware no one thinks I should drive, not even if my cunt is steering. You admit that kind of intrigues you. I like it so much when you're intrigued, but I can't do that right now. I can't have anything at all. I'm too far away and too tired. I told you I would do it later. I told you I would do it if I could. I told you I wanted to be alone for as long as. All right, thanks guys. I'm gonna stop reading now and we can chat.
Thank you so much, Jenny.
Thank you.
So in just a minute, Dere, one of our MFA students, is going to facilitate a Q&A with Jenny. It'll be the first half will be just a conversation between her and Jenny, and the second half will be opened up to audience questions. To summarize, for those of you who weren't here at the beginning, you can submit questions to me directly through the chat. And if your question is selected, I will enable your audio and video. And you can ask it directly, or you can indicate when you ask your question to me through the chat that you'd like me to ask the question on your behalf, and that's fine too. It's also great, you're welcome to submit questions while Dre and Jenny are talking. And it's also great if you can say something about who you are. You know, if you're an undergrad student, an MFA student with the Zell Writers Program, you're from Seattle or Chicago or whatever you want to say to your about yourself, that would be lovely. So Dere, I'll turn it over to you and you can get us started.
Great, thank you so much, Ashley. Hi, I'm Dere. I'm a student in the Helen Zell MFA program. I'm a second year and I'm a fiction writer. And it is my honor today to spend the next hour in Jenny's company. Thank you so much, Jenny, for that exquisite incantatory reading and for being here for my questions as well as those of the audience. I've been following along the journey of my baby first birthday online and on social media. So it was wonderful to hear your poems and your own voice. And I'll sort of start off just because, I mean, we all know Anish also talked about how you're kind of a master of the multi-genre just like movement across genres. Most recently, that's been from, so Sour Heart came out in 2017 and My Baby First Birthday just came out this spring. And how has that switch been from fiction to poetry, both personally and also in terms of like reception and how people have interacted with it, given that like, in light of like Sour Heart.
Yeah, I'm so excited to be talking to you. It's a good question. I was meeting with some MFA students. Perhaps I was even talking about this with Anisha this morning, but we were talking about, I think I was talking with Jennifer. This morning about working in different genres and how to juggle that. And, you know, there's just been this thing that's been happening ever since the pandemic and all the other horrible things that have been going on where I'm realizing that to get through life, it's very useful to be like numb to certain things and to have prepared answers. And I think that's like a very valid and useful way to be. And I think I've gotten so used to giving prepared answers to certain questions that come up, which was very useful because it just helps. It just was helpful to not have to like start from scratch each time and rack my brains. But I think it's been in the last few months, like I've been like trying to think about the questions that I get asked a lot and try to actually come up with an answer that's like true to this moment, that maybe isn't as prepared, that maybe even has a kernel of feeling. And I'm thinking like, why do I write in different genres? What does it feel like to do that? And I think in some ways it's just natural, because I've never felt like there was a space that all my different selves could exist in simultaneously in an integrated and whole way. I don't know, maybe a lot of people feel that way. You know, and I've had to navigate a lot of different spaces in my life. I've navigated spaces where nobody reads, and the thought of reading is ridiculous because you're working 18 hours a day and you're exhausted the minute your head hits the pillow. I've navigated spaces where people were read, you know, Jane Austen when they were in utero by their professor parents, and they were literate before they were, you know, even an entity in the physical seeable world. I've navigated spaces where everyone is Chinese, and I've navigated spaces where everyone is white, and I've had to like learn how to seamlessly do that. And it's always felt fragmented and compartmentalized. And I've always felt like I'm switching between different registers, and it's unconscious at this point. I don't have to consciously try. And so for better or worse, I don't think that's a good thing. I think it's good to be integrated and to find a sanctuary where all yourselves can exist, whether it's in writing or in a person or in a home or in a place or whatever, in a community. But because I hadn't for so long and continue not to, it always made sense to switch between these different things. And it just always felt seamless. And it wasn't even like a conscious thing. It's just like, there are certain things I can only express in this language. There are certain things I can only express around these people. And in the same way, there are certain things I can only express in poetry, and there are certain things I want to express in prose. There are certain things I want to express in nonfiction, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And if anything, I would like, yeah, I think that's just kind of where I'm at with that. And it makes sense also that I said everything I wanted to say at the time in fiction with Sour Heart, and I didn't really have more I wanted to say for a little while in that world. Yeah, that's a long answer to your wonderful question.
No, that's that actually reminds me, we had Ilya Kaminsky last semester. Everything before March is kind of a blur now, but I think he also kind of made that connection between like transnational movement and sort of flipping between genres, and how it can sometimes make sense, especially if your life already feels fragmented to you. So that, yeah, that's sort of reminded me of that. But so sort of like talking more about your like switching between genres, you said that that's kind of like your impulse to do so, but do you think that there's something specific that happens to your writing by virtue of that constant movement? Like, do you think, I don't know, like, do you think there's a particular way in that feeds into your work?
I suppose that I don't feel, it's interesting. I don't know, I guess I don't feel very constricted by the expectations of, like, I guess I have a suspicion of identity categories in general. I think they're really useful, and it's only human to categorize people and categorize things, but I guess it just doesn't matter to me. Like a short story can read like an essay can read like fiction, a poem can have narrative or not have narrative, I guess it just makes me feel a little like, who cares? Like what something is supposed to do. It's not something, I don't know how to answer that question except to say, I feel, it just made me feel like I am the person who decides what I want to do in each supposed genre, and it doesn't matter what's already been done or what is supposed to happen. Mm-hmm. And it just doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's very encouraging to hear, because I do think that like some of us as readers and like beginning writers sort of do worry a lot about those distinctions and like kind of do like, oh, I'm a fiction writer, like poetry is something I only read and admire from the distance. So it's always great to hear from someone who doesn't, who thinks of those categorizations as very artificial in a way. Mm-hmm. And sort of to your point, I did, when I was reading We Love You, Crispina from Sour Heart, and even hearing you read the story right now, or like part of the story, you can hear like the rhythms of poetry even in your fiction. So I can totally see the return to poetry like feeling just innate and natural to you. I know that My Baby First Birthday came out this spring. And how was that experience of having your work come out at when the world is kind of falling around you?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think because I had the opportunity to publish something and was enormously like privileged to have a lot of attention for my story collection, Sour Heart, and I felt like I'd shared it with all the people. I felt like the people I had hoped could find it had multiple ways of finding it. So I think it would have been, I think it's different for all the debut writers who didn't have that experience, mm-hmm. especially the debut writers who were publishing stuff like in March and April and really had that experience robbed from them. So in some ways I didn't feel, I guess I'm just trying to say like, I had no feeling of like, oh no, I'm not going to get the reception I hoped for. If anything, I went maybe a little too far in the other direction, to be honest, where I was like, who cares about this thing I wrote? Like, I don't even care. I don't want people to care about this. Like, it would be a lie for me to pretend like I care. And a part of me was like, great, I'll do no press. It'll just be nothing because there's other things that I'm even focused on. And I think, you know, I don't know if that was the right reaction or not, but I had it for quite a while. And then I think, I guess I realized that I was doing like a disservice to myself, a disservice to the people who worked on the book other than me, and also a disservice to this idea that like, yes, the world changed, but also the world didn't change. Like the world is still the same. Like what led to the world as it is now is still the same world, and the themes are always the same. The propensity towards self-annihilation, the propensity to loneliness is still the same. Like the themes are always the same of loneliness and alienation and trauma, and that we have to reckon with like the past to like deal with the present. And I think I tried as hard as I could to not just abandon all this stuff that I had done. It's still hard, to be honest. I still have a hard time sometimes connecting with what I wrote, to be totally, totally, totally honest. But I didn't want to be tyrannical in just because I no longer connected with what I wrote that nobody else can. So that's my absolutely honest answer to your question.
Yeah. No, thank you so much for the candor. And I think, I think that you might feel that way, but I feel like your poems, so many of them hit on so much stuff that it's just as relevant as before. And kind of on that, I read an interview with you, I think it was in the Creative Independent, in which you sort of mentioned that you go through phases of being interested in particular themes. And of course that was like childhood and family and Sour Heart. In My Baby First Birthday, you've expanded that canvas much more, and you grapple with innocence and violence and who gets to be innocent and the patriarchy, capitalism, so much more. Is there, of course your book just came out, but are there things that are kind of nagging at you currently, as of today, things that you're interested in at the moment?
Yeah, that's such a good question. Yeah, with Sour Heart, obviously I was interested in childhood and questions of being indebted to those that come before you and the inheritance of trauma. And with My Baby First Birthday, which I guess is actually very relevant to this moment right now, I was very concerned with the question of we don't choose to be born, and yet we're born into a world that is often very, very, very scary and inhospitable. And that first moment of existence is not a consensual one, but also if you're lucky enough, you can get to a place where you're thank God I was born. It's both why the fuck was I born, and thank God I was born and experienced all this and met all these people. And I think right now it's a very, very new thing, but I am kind of interested in healing and what would it take to heal? When the pandemic first happened, I was living with my friend, the wonderful poet Tommy Pico. And a few weeks before even anything was the lockdowns were happening, I had this this feeling something bad was gonna happen. And I bought from Costco 130 rolls of toilet paper. It was a crazy amount of toilet paper. And I kept having this image in my mind, and I was didn't know where it came from, but of anarchy in the streets, and that I would suddenly have to squat in the middle of the street, pull down my pants, take a dump, and there'd be no toilet paper because it's in the street. And then some mysterious figure wearing a shiny black boot would literally kick the shit off my ass. And that's I was no, I can't let that happen. I have to have toilet paper with me, as the world descends into chaos. And I was thinking about that, and I was where the hell did this fear come from? That's never happened to me before. And then I suddenly remembered weeks later that, my grandmother had this story of living in this village where there was a shit kicker in the village because there was no plumbing or toilet paper, and people did literally squat over holes. And there was a guy with a shiny black boot who'd literally clean the shit off people's asses. And it made me realize every single thing I fear is not just because of what happened to me in this life that I'm in, but it's so many generations of lack and scarcity and pain. And only way is to heal that now, so that I don't continue. The only way is to end my bloodline, or if I want to continue it, or even just continue my own life, I have to find some way to heal that. And that started off being a very daunting thing, because I'm how the fuck do I heal the last 800 years of what led to this very moment of me buying 130 rolls of toilet paper when I don't need to do that? But also I was maybe it's an opportunity, because I can maybe do that, because I am living a life that no one before me in my lineage has ever lived. And maybe I should be maybe that should be sacred to me in some way, and maybe I should do something with that, because what's the alternative? Just being in pain and dying and passing that on, I can't. So I think now that's what I'm interested in, which is like, what will it take for people to decide to heal the pain of their lineage and trauma, even if we were not responsible, even if we cannot be responsible for the macro conditions that created that trauma, we still have to be responsible for healing as an individual, even if we are not responsible because the structures that were installed and created were responsible. Does that make sense at all?
Yeah. It does, and I'm very excited to see what comes of that new obsession. And that's a great anecdote. That's crazy. I guess this is sort of related, maybe. So I was, when you were reading your poem, and it was the refrain that begins with "It's just." And that, I mean, it was really powerful. There's a line in there, or there are verses that say, how was I supposed to know? The more I talk about my pain, the more white people literally profit. I think and I think so many of us feel just that exhaustion that you refer to, and that kind of like impossibility where, I mean, it's just like, what do you do to escape that kind of like, whether you call it like capitalism or you call it just like a race thing or whatever it is, like how do you kind of move past this? Or if you don't move past it, like where do you find solace from that impossibility of being able to produce something that doesn't get turned into, you know, a way for people to profit?
Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know. I think that it's something that I'm still grappling with, because there is such a voracious appetite to read about and see depictions of, you know, of trauma and pain from the very people who are the most traumatized. And I guess it relates to healing, where I'm like, oftentimes that doesn't lead to more healing. It doesn't lead to a change in the material conditions that would be required to heal. And, you know, I remember when all of the Me Too stuff was happening, I would get all these requests from editors that I didn't know. And they were well-meaning, of course, but these requests of, you know, I'd get in my email inbox, just a random person being like, hey, do you want to write about the time you were sexually assaulted? And I was kind of like, first of all, I've never said that I was. I haven't chosen to share that at all. So you're making this assumption. Second of all, does your publication have a history of like knowing how to support writers who do choose to share that? Or am I just gonna like relive some horrible experience I've had so that your publication can pat themselves on the back for this, for me having done that? And then what changes? Like, what is the justice that is served? What is the restorative justice that is served? What is the collective action that comes out of that? What comes out of that for not just me, but all the people who read it and are re-traumatized, other than the re-traumatizing? You know, like, it's like at the end of that, like, nothing changes. And that was very disturbing to me. And I felt very trapped by that. And that is not to say, you know, that's a very nihilistic way of putting it. And I actually don't even agree with that thinking anymore. And I do think things have changed, but I do believe to some extent that things change through collective action and organizing, and that is separate from writing. And that doesn't mean writing doesn't have the power to inspire collective action and organizing, but they are two separate things. And I do think that I'm done conflating the sharing of something bad that happened to me so that white people and institutions and organizations with money don't have to be accountable with actual change through organizing and collective action. And I think I'm done with that. And I'm just gonna write now things that I want to write, that I want to share, and I'm not going to conflate that with like a change in the material conditions of like my life or anyone else's life.
That's, yeah, no, that's wonderful and inspiring. And I, it reminds me, I think there's this line from the New Zadie Smith, one of her essays says that the people demand change, they rarely ever demand writing, which I mean, yeah, it's, I think that as powerful as we think writing to be, it's so important to have that distinction in your mind.
Writing is still powerful. Like pleasure is still powerful. Like creativity is still powerful. It's powerful to have like, you know, like a living wage, and it's powerful to like abolish like all the horrible, like, you know, sort of like policing institutions. But like in the abolishing of it, and I think this is what like abolitionists believe in, you have to like also create like a dream that feels good. Like you have to create a reason to live. And I think that comes from art and beauty and all those other things that writing does do. So I'm like still a deep advocate for writing.
Yeah, yeah, no, for sure. Okay, sort of changing tracks a little bit. I read, I think it was in the Good Times. So I think it was December maybe, when there was an article in the New York Times about this wonderful book group, or like not book group, like a writing group that you have had. I don't know if pandemic changed anything, but in New York with Karen Mahajan and Alessola Kim and others. And I think for like those of us who are currently creative writing students and workshop and such, how did you guys manage to like sort of continue that and like have it still maintain structure and still like have sort of value for you so many years down the line?
Yes, that's a great question. Yes, so it was a writing group that I founded my sophomore year of college at Stanford. And it came out of, you know, like a nerdy desire to like not just take creative writing classes, but also like have a really rigorous, like, you know, meeting of like who I thought were cool writers on like a kind of like regular basis. And it was a lifeline for me. I don't want to speak for any of the other writers, but you know, it ended up being a group, the group, so it's been around since like 2003. So, you know, almost like two decades. And I think the reason why it just continued was because that group of people, Karen Mahajan and Tony Tulatamudi and Alessola Kim and Anthony Ha and Wahini Vara, like, they were my lifeline. At times when I felt like I didn't have mentors, or the mentors I did have were leading me astray, or I felt like I wasn't connecting with people in the various places I went to learn writing, like they became my peer mentors. And I think, sometimes I think mentorship, that word, is a very like neoliberal concept, because it's all about like some kind of weird like picking out of someone for like individual attention. I'm like much more into like a collective sharing of resources in a horizontal way. And that's what that group became. It became a way for my peers to share resources with with each other. And that helped me more than any kind of mentor relationship that I've ever had. And frankly, I've never had mentor relationships. Mm-hmm. And the few fake ones I've had have been toxic. And the opposite of helpful, they've been an impediment to me continuing forward. So it just was natural. And it was like, again, fun. Like, writing is so difficult that to merge writing and deadlines with meeting with people that I just like as friends and people made it better to write towards deadlines. And it's been a lifeline during this pandemic. We still continue to meet on video chat. I hope that it like lasts forever. And I hope everyone can create like a group like that, because it's just really great.
Yeah, that's wonderful. I have a lot more questions, but I'm also mindful of the fact that the chat has been filling up with a lot of questions as well. So Ashley, who is going to be our first interrogator?
All right. So our first audience member to ask a question is going to be Trisha, who is a lecturer at the University of Edinburgh in Scotland. She and a number of her students, one of whom is also going to ask a question, are joining us all the way from Scotland, which is pretty awesome. So let me turn on her video here. Here she comes. Hi, Trisha.
Who is that? Quickest promotion I've ever seen in the academic world. What's the crack? How's it going? I just go now?
Yeah, you can go ahead and ask your question. Go for it.
Glad the lightning here is so unflattering. So I'm not actually underwater, it's just a green room. Jenny, I just want to say, first of all, thank you so, 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 and, you know, indefinitely much, not just for your reading, but for your work more generally. I'm really fortunate. When you were, everything you just said, whoever from the class is listening, I hope you sort of taking notes on that section about avoiding the sort of neoliberal tendencies to specialize and separate and instead working collaboratively based on a sort of a model of friendship. Jenny, I'll stop now. Thank you. We all love your work. The reaction's been great. The question I was going to ask is, one of the frameworks we're looking at is the idea of conceptualizing the contemporary and what's distinctive about writing in the 21st century moment. So a lot of this involves tracing the lineage of modernism in writing. I know you've often been compared to Joyce in your scatological interests, and Becca perhaps in some of the absurdity of your writing. I wondered how you felt about those lineages, and also particularly how you feel about the idea of the fragment, which was so central in modernist writing, but seems to me to be very radically reformulated in your work. And it also asked if you'd read Milkman, because it seems very connected to some of your thinking about trauma here, but that is enough from me.
Thank you so much for your comments and your question. What was the last thing if I read?
Milkman by Anna Burns.
No, but I should.
Have a look, yeah.
That's such a good question. Yeah, I was very inspired by Joyce and Beckett, and those were authors I read when I was in high school and much younger. You know, I think inspiration can be a tricky thing, and my references can be a tricky thing, because there are also things I really didn't like about Joyce and Beckett, and I think that's okay. But I took what I liked and I tried to improve upon it in my own way. And I was very drawn to the repetition and scatological concerns of both of those writers. But I also wanted to, at the risk of sounding corny, to infuse it with like heart and love. I really care about love. I really care about loving others and myself. And sometimes I felt a little bit alienated from that sort of, you know, modernist and postmodernist way of writing, because it felt so up here and like so in the mind. And so that's kind of like where I'm coming at it from. But I think, yeah, I don't know what else to say, except obviously I feel like a very fragmented person trying to become whole in my life as a person and my life as a writer. And perhaps that is a concern of this time for, in a global sense, beyond myself.
Great. Thank you, Trisha. That was wonderful. And it's so great to know there's people joining from, I don't know, it must be very late in Scotland. I kind of had, I had a question that was sort of related. I wanted to know what writers have influenced your work. And I mean, you kind of like sort of spoke a little bit to that, but I'll kind of expand that question. Are there art forms beyond writing that feed into your work, particular artists or just general like forms that you take inspiration from?
Yeah, I really love film. I've been watching movies lately. I've been watching Uncle Boonmi and Syndromes in a Century by this Thai writer whose name I don't wanna butcher, so I'm not gonna try. It's like Thai filmmaker. I think his name is Achipat. I'm not gonna butcher it. And then I really like the films of Ozu. His films have really touched me. Some films by Ingmar Bergman have really touched me. The film, My Dinner with Andre really touched me. Music really touches me. The music of Mitski has been very like meaningful to me. Sometimes, yeah, you know, I don't say this facetiously, but like my texts with my friends are very inspiring to me. I think that they're poetry. My texts in my group chat with my parents is something I'm inspired by. Typos I'm inspired by. The strange things that happen when you're texting in a flurry and it becomes poetry because you're stuttering and responding to things that happened three, you know, lines ago. I find that extremely inspiring.
Yeah. Anisha and I have fangirled over your writings on Mitski. So yeah, no, those were great. Okay, Ashley, who's our next question?
All right, the next question I'm going to read on this person's behalf. This is from Nicole Christian, who is a writer in Detroit. What, if anything, are you still afraid to write, either as a narrative or a poem? And this second question you spoke to a little bit already, but, and who are your most surprising badass literary sheroes?
I don't know why, if they're surprising, but okay, good question. Well, the first question, what am I still afraid to write about? God, like so much, like, you know, all writing is scary. Everything has consequences. I think everything I write about, I'm scared to write about. It's a good thing because if you're scared, it means you really care about the thing and you're scared you'll do it disservice and injustice. If it's not scary, then you probably don't care about it very much. You know, it's like, it is a little bit you should fear for the things that you love and care about deeply. So I would say everything. Most surprising literary heroes. I mean, I don't know if they're surprising. I think I would just say my friends, like they are really radiantly beautiful and inspiring people to me. My friend Alice Sola Kim, who's a fiction writer, my friend Tommy Pico, who I mentioned, who is this awesome poet, my friend Morgan Parker, who is also an amazing poet. My friend Leopoldine Kaur, who's an amazing poet and fiction writer. I'm very inspired by, them and by their friendship.
Great, thank you. I was reading online that Sour Heart is being adapted into film. That is super exciting. Correct me if I'm wrong, but you're part of that process of turning it into like a visual media, or?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would love to know how that's going and how like turning your words into like a different medium, what that experience is like.
It's really interesting because so much of the stories are so interior and private, and film is a very visual medium, and we have to glean the interiors of characters through what we see and what they do. And I don't often think like that. So it's been a big learning process to think that way. And I think it's also very interesting. It's very embodied, because in writing a script, you're imagining an actual live human being saying those words and playing that character. And there's something about that that has been like emotional. Not that it wasn't, I mean, it actually wasn't emotional to write these stories, despite what it may seem like, but it's more emotional somehow imagining an actual human being embodying these characters. So I would say that's like the biggest learning thing I've had to grapple with.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's fascinating. Like, how do you turn something that's super just introspective into something that like relies so heavily on dialogue and scene, and that's fascinating. I know that we don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to turn it over more generously to the audience, because I've hogged up a lot of your time. So Ashley, who is our next question?
All right, so this question is from Laura. I'm going to read it on her behalf. She is a prospective MFA applicant to the Helen Zell Writers Program. And she says, in an increasingly hectic and tumultuous landscape of information competing for our attention and empathy, where do you locate the place of poetics within this economy of attention?
You're either asking the extremely right person or the extremely wrong person, because I don't have Twitter. I have an Instagram account, but I don't have it on my phone. And now Instagram has made it impossible to like look at it unless you log in. I don't have Facebook. I will go days without reading the news. That probably speaks to some kind of lack of civic engagement or something, but I guess my answer is like, don't, in not abandoning the world, you also can't abandon yourself. And sometimes it feels like you have to abandon yourself to be there for the world. And sometimes that's true. And I felt like abandoning myself and my writing in March and April, because I felt like, who the fuck cares? I felt like abandoning myself when George Floyd and Breonna Taylor were murdered. And I was like, who the fuck cares about what I'm interested in? But then I think it's, you do have to find a way to show up for yourself in a sustainable way. And I think, and this isn't like a very thought out answer, but the short answer is just like, it's okay to be like, it's important for me for the next few hours to not read the news, or it's okay to wake up in the morning and not read the news until I've written for a few hours. I think that's okay. And it's something that each person has to manage for themselves. And maybe that's not something you do every day. maybe it's something you do on Tuesdays and Thursdays. I don't know, but there's no other way, because once you get sucked into all the problems of the world, then you're sucked into all the problems of the world, and they're there no matter what you're doing for your writing.
Thank you. Yeah, I had something similar as a question as well. Yeah, Ashley, you can go.
You can go for it too. Go for it.
Oh, no. I was gonna just turn it over to you, so.
Okay. All right, so this next question is from Becky. She is an English literature undergraduate, at Edinburgh University, again in Scotland, joining us all the way from Scotland. So let me pull this up. She says, I've actually just covered Sourheart in one of my courses, and I was wondering, the puke and shit which splatters the pages transgresses social conventions of politeness, and it often made me uncomfortable. The bodily functions you put to paper challenged, and in so doing, made me aware of a lot of assumptions and conventions which I hold around what you can and can't talk about: childhood sexual exploration, trauma, abuse, and so much more. Why did you choose to explore these often shied away from topics and words? Do you have any political or personal goals? And did it feel natural, or was it uncomfortable for you to put it to paper? Thank you so much.
That's a really good question. I don't know. I get asked this a lot. And again, going back and trying not to give a prepared answer and trying to actually remember like what it felt like to write it. I will be honest, it wasn't difficult for me to write it as far as a first draft. I wasn't writing it because in my mind I was like, this will shock everyone. It didn't come terribly difficultly. I would say that I grew up in a way and in an environment where the things that were never talked about caused a lot of harm and a lot of pain. And I never, ever, 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 ever wanted to contribute to the causing of more harm and pain by refusing to talk about something. And so coming out of that, writing was my place to be free to talk about anything without being censured, without being judged, without being lectured or scolded or punished in some, or, you know, it was the one place in my life where I was free. I had literally no other place in my life where I was free. And I cherished that. And I think that the thing that I'm still grappling with is when you choose to publish something, it can't just be about like what you want to do, right? There's still a responsibility to others. And then there's the question of harm again, which is like, even if this might be healing for someone, what if it's harmful to someone else? And that I don't have the answer for. Like, I had to grapple with that. And I had ultimately to just find a way to live with myself and believe that what I had to share was more liberating and healing than it was harmful. But I don't know, to be honest. I can't rest easy in that. And I may be wrong. And if so, I have to live with that. And that's hard to live with. But all I can say is that there continues to be no other space in my life where I feel completely free except when I write alone without the intention of sharing it. And then I have to decide, when I decide I want to share it, what to do about what I've written, if that makes sense. That's kind of how I deal with it.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. And thank you so much again for your honesty. Really inspiring. Ashley, I know that we have a bunch of other questions.
So this next question is from Sophia, who I think all I know about her, she's from Ann Arbor. So I'll let her introduce herself.
Hi there. I'm a master's student at the University of Michigan, and I'm here in Ann Arbor. And I think my question kind of follows up on the answer you just gave. My question was kind of what got you started writing and what made you decide to start publishing that writing?
Thank you for that question. I started writing because I had so much to say and not a lot of places where I could say it, not a lot of people who I could say it to without them lashing out at me or walking away. I just had a lot to say. I wanted to talk to someone. There was no one to talk to. So I talked to myself and I created these worlds, and that was the beginning of me wanting to write. Why did I want to publish it? That's a bigger question, isn't it? I think there was some, and maybe it's delusional, but some belief that I had that what I wanted to say could create, I'm trying to be careful in how I phrase this because I don't know if it's even true, but on some level, I believed that I had something to offer the world and that it would be worthwhile to offer it. In the same way that, like, I read a lot of books growing up and some of them were just whatever, but every once in a while I'd read something that would just like save me and help me get through my life. And I just thought like that person had to have like the hubris or delusion that it would like find me, like not me, but like someone who needed it. And I just felt like maybe I felt like I should do the same. But I will also say not everything I write, I publish, and there's plenty of things I write just to write. And I don't feel like it needs to be found by anyone. But yeah, I do have this desire to share what I have to say with others.
Great. I think we might be at time, Ashley.
Yeah, I think we'll end it there.
Okay. Thank you so much, Jenny. This was so wonderful and honest and candid. And I think we all had a great time. It was just the best thing that has happened this week. So I will hand it over to Ashley for some final announcements.
Thank you so much.
And just to echo that, what a powerful conversation. Thank you so much. Okay, so a few quick announcements. I posted in the chat a link to buy Jenny Zhang's books from Literati, which is our wonderful local independent bookstore in Ann Arbor. They probably ship to Scotland. also, if you want to sign up for our email list to get updates on upcoming events, it's a real quick Google form you can fill out, and I posted that link in the chat as well. And everyone is welcome. It is open to the public. Jenny will give a craft lecture tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. Eastern time, titled Bringing Literary Sensibilities to Film and TV. That's from 10 to 11 o'clock tomorrow morning. So everyone is welcome to join. The format is a little different. It's a little bit more informal. Audience members will be able to see each other. It's like a typical Zoom meeting format, not a webinar format. So have a lovely evening, Jenny. Thank you so much. Dari, thank you so much. And we'll see you tomorrow, hopefully.
Thank you all so, so much.
All right. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, Ashley.
Thanks.